I don't work on ion channels, so I have to apologize for that, but we work on something like ion channels that we make from DNA, okay? So I chose that title because I want to show you what the possibilities are that DNA nanotechnology gives us for designing ion channels and porins, actually, and maybe understanding them and making better ones, okay? So I'm, of course, not the only one in my group who's doing their work, and the main part of the work that I will show today was actually done by Kerstin Göpfrich. She also had a poster at the conference here about some aspects of the work. I will show a little bit more. And then we have, I would like to acknowledge the collaboration with Tim Liedl in Munich, who actually showed my group how to use DNA nanotechnology. And then we got our DNA modified by Eugen Stulz's group in Southampton. And we also had a collaboration with Jonathan Burns and Stefano Walker at UCL. Okay, so just to make absolutely clear that I'm a physicist, okay, I will show you what I find interesting about ion channels or channels in general. Okay, so these are colloidal particles, so the size is 500 nanometers. These are two reservoirs that contain a lot of this water and a little bit of ions, and the particles are basically model systems for sugar transporters or drugs or something else. And then we connected these two reservoirs with channels. Yeah, you see them here running in parallel. And these are open. As you can see here, there's a particle going in. There's no bias applied. It's just diffusion. And the interesting thing is now you see that there's very high concentration of these particles in both reservoirs. There's nothing keeping them out of the channels. But what you can, I think what we can all agree on is these channels are pretty empty, OK? So fundamentally, this means that translocation is a rare event, okay? Especially if it's not driven, okay? Many biological systems, of course, use diffusion or active energy, but fundamentally, it's actually not so easy to get something into the channels. And that got us thinking that if you look at biological systems, yeah, they all rely on membrane transport for communication, yeah? So you have these proteins and ion channels that regulate transport through lipid membranes. And the other interesting thing about biological channels is, for me as a physicist, that of course they operate on completely or quite different length scales. Okay, so at one point you have the nuclear pore complex that has a diameter, let's say, of around 50 nanometers. You have the multiporin channels that have a diameter of around 5 nanometers, already a factor of 10 smaller. And then, of course, you have the ion channels that are even more, another factor of 10 smaller. So you have a huge size range here in these channels. And still, nature comes up with all these kind of different channel designs. And translocation is rare. So what I'm interested in to understand, what are the generic principles in these kind of systems? What can we learn about the system? Yeah. So. And in a way, what I want to address in this talk, and what is funded by the ESC grant that we recently got, is that we want to create structures that mimic membrane proteins, and this should include their functionality. And the goal here is to really gain insight in nature's mechanisms to control molecular transport through membranes, okay? And of course, my hope would be that this will feed back into drug design for antibiotics, for instance, and all kinds of other things. Of course, this is a big hope, but sometimes it's good to have big goals, okay? And of course, the technology that we use is DNA origami to build these proteins, and I'm coming from the Cavendish lab where Watson and Crick came up with a base pairing mechanism that defines the double strand helix of DNA. And this is a photograph of the model, of the original model. So it's a copy of the model that Watson and Crick built to emphasize the double strand of DNA. So you see the backbone stands, the phosphate backbones with the bases here. And the nice thing now for physicists that almost, if you understand that you have an AT base pairing and a GC base pair, and you just assume that these are just straight rods, yeah, that these are the backbones connected by these kind of linkers, then you could almost think that this might be a building material, okay? So if you can see them as Lego bricks, you can assemble them maybe into making three-dimensional structures beyond the state of the art of protein folding, okay? Because what the nice thing about DNA is that you already have structural elements that combine four strands, so you have a green DNA strand, a red, yellow, and blue, and if you mix them together with the right sequence, they actually form a structural element that makes a cross of DNA, okay? And if you have this structural element, if you combine them into different shapes, you can actually make arbitrary shapes. So in Paul Rossmann, in 2006, had a cover on Nature, that you see here, that he created this nice smiley, and the smiley is actually entirely made out of DNA, and the size here is around 50 nanometers, so it's approaching the size of a nuclear pore complex, and for me as a nanopore person, the eye looked like a nanopore, okay? So I already saw there, maybe we can use this material to actually build something, nanopores from these structures, and a few years, only 3 years later, then people actually figured out how to make this 2D material into 3D structures, so each of this rods here is now a double-strand DNA molecule, so you will see many of these structural things now in the talk. So each of these rods now is a double-strand DNA molecule, so you see one strand is gray, one is red, wrapped around each other, so this is a double-strand DNA molecule, and then Tim Deedle and William Shi at Harvard actually showed that you can actually make really three-dimensional structures with that, okay? So the important thing for this is, and I again want to remind you that I'm a physicist, so in principle we have no idea about chemistry, and I'm partly proud of it. I'm getting less and less proud because I now, never, anyway, I should have learned more. But basically, the point is with this technology, you can really program these shapes by just buying off-the-shelf DNA, okay? So you, there's a computer program where you can design these kind of systems, and the size here in the scale bar here is normally a few nanometers, so again, I told you the smiley is 50 nanometers across, and I think this is amazing control in these kind of systems. So you have control over structure and on the nanometer length scale by harnessing these DNA self-assembling. It's all based, of course, on Watson-Crick's base pairing, okay? So, why is it called DNA origami? For some of the larger structures, what you actually do, you take a long gray strand here, so you can, I hope this is not a molecular dynamic simulation, it's actually an illustration of the process. So you have a long gray strand here of DNA, where you know the sequence of, because of course sequence technology is now available, and then you mix it with small strands of DNA that connect different parts of this DNA molecule, okay? And if you do this, oops, sorry, you can actually now, yeah, for instance, this red strand would connect these two red regions in this DNA molecule, and this red strand can be 40 bases long. This is 20, this is 20, and then you get an 8, yeah, so you connect these two structures, and then if you add a lot of these short paper strands, you can actually fold your structure into a sheet, yeah. And the other important thing about this is that this is a completely, it's like cooking, yeah, so you mix everything together, heat it up to 80 degrees, put it into a PCR cycler, cool it down overnight, and then you have billions of these structures in solution that are virtually identical, okay? And the other great thing is that you know in principle where every of these strands go. So you see that, so it's supposed to be that all these strands have a different color because you know where each of the stable strands sits, okay? What means you have an addressable system because you know exactly where the green strand goes, so you can actually add some chemical modifications to this. Yeah, so you can add hydrophobic groups that you will use later. You can use other modified bases to this molecule. Or you can use dye molecules to actually make these structures fluorescent, okay? So you have a full range of possibilities to functionalize these structures with, in principle, nanometer precision, okay? So of course these structures are not as rigid as proteins or amino acid sequences from proteins, but it's in principle possible, okay? So you already saw this, and then a few years ago, we actually was interested more in molecular sensing, so we made a DNA plate with a nanopore here, yeah, so this is a nanopore, this would be one eye of the smiley. We can also make a three-dimensional pore that is actually like a funnel shape, so this is a side view and this is a top view, and here you see a pore that is around 6 nanometers. So the nice thing about this, we got a patent on this, and then Oxford Nanopore got interested in licensing the technology, so we are now trying to commercialize these kind of sensing systems in their system, but fundamentally, with DNA origami, this means that you can actually build three-dimensional objects on length scales that are really approaching biological systems, okay? Good. And now let me come to the membrane protein part, okay? So now, of course, if you look at a membrane protein, you can think about what do I have to do to convert DNA into a functional object that can maybe conduct ions and other molecules through a lipid membrane. Okay, so the problem is, of course, that lipid membranes are, for physicists, oily films, so they are hydrophobic. So of course DNA is hydrophilic, yeah? So blue is now hydrophilic and red is hydrophobic, what means that if I have only DNA, of course this will never go into a membrane. And this is of course the biggest problem for gene delivery, that you normally can't cross, get DNA going through lipid membranes. However, there are toxins in nature where you actually have amphiphilic molecules, where this is Staphylococcus aureus derived alpha amylasin that attacks red blood cells, for instance. Yeah, it has a hydrophobic stem region and a hydrophilic head. So if you can do this with DNA, then I think we are in business, because if you can now modify the DNA molecule and add a hydrophobic functionality, you should be able to build an artificial membrane protein. Okay, and this is exactly what I will show you. And what I also already showed you, that in principle, we would like to have a large variety of function-dependent structures, because this is coming from nature. They should be anchored in lipid membranes, should be able to mediate the flux of ions and other molecules, and ideally they should also be responsive to external stimuli, meaning channel blockers or gating, yeah, voltage gating. And this is a goal that we did, and this is a cartoon of a structure that we designed. So this is a DNA nanopore, so this is now a pore that is much smaller than the ones that I showed you before. It's actually consisting of double-stranded DNA, six strands of DNA actually that are held together. So this is each of these rods now is a double-stranded DNA molecule, and the red molecules here are the hydrophobic tags that will hold it into the membrane, pull it into the membrane. Okay, and there are different possibilities for hydrophobicity, but we chose porphyrin, or if I say we got this molecule from Eugen Stulz in Southampton. So he put the porphyrin molecule on these DNA strands for us to make it actually hydrophobic, to make it interact with the lipid membrane. Okay, and here you see porphyrin. It's a nice molecule because actually it's a bifunctional system, because it's not only a hydrophobic tag, but it's also a fluorescent label. Okay, so you can not only pull your DNA structures onto the lipid membrane and into the lipid membrane, but you can also directly visualize them at the same time. Okay. Good. So how does the structures look? And again, this is a wireframe diagram. So this would be very similar to not a three-dimensional structure, but to the amino acid sequence of a protein. And what you see here, that this is how the design works. So you have six different DNA strands. Yeah, the green one, yellow, red, blue, dark gray, and light gray. Okay, these are six different strands. And now we can actually added the porphyrin tags to these positions here to make an asymmetric channel, so that these two regions are hydrophobic now. And the nice thing, as I said already, you can also see this in the microscope, because it's actually now fluorescent. Okay, so we have the required hydrophobicity by adding this molecule, and we have a fluorescent label. The other nice thing about DNA, of course, you can characterize it easily. You can put it onto an atomic force microscope. You can do gel electrophoresis to check if everything is correctly folded. So this is very easy to compare to, I think, to working with membrane proteins. These structures are very, very easy to characterize if they are correctly folded. Okay. So how do we do the measurements? Or if I say we, I should point to Kerstin, who actually did these measurements. So what we do is we make very simple measurements. We take giant unilamellar vesicles. Of course, this is not drawn to scale here, and use a Nanyon type setup where we use a glass capillary. We apply a suction in the capillary. We draw the vesicles on there and have the pores already in these vesicles, and then we measure the current here. And if we have no current, we have a gigaohm seal. And if we have a DNA pore in there, we actually see a current, a finite current in the system here. Okay. The nice thing about the system, it's very fast. You can draw tens of vesicles onto one single capillary, and you can get a good amount of statistics with the system. So we can really characterize it in a way. Okay. So the first thing what you of course do, you measure all these vesicles, and then you try to get a conductance of your channels. And here's a histogram here of these lipid channels. So this is conductance that we measure. This is the number of events, and you see that you have a roughly peak around 250 picosiemens. Okay, so this pore is a 6-helix pore, has an inner diameter of 2 nanometers, so this conductance is a little bit too small. Okay, so what we believe here is what is actually happening, that this pore has collapsed because of lateral pressure of the membrane. However, you can still measure current voltage characteristics. So if you plot the current as a function of voltage of these of an average of these pores, so this is why we have arrow bars here, you actually see that you get a roughly linear current voltage characteristic that made us very confident that we actually see designed systems. Okay, so this is a 6-helix pore with an inner diameter of probably a collapsed pore with a small inner diameter. And now comes the nice thing about it, is if you apply 100 millivolt voltage, you actually can close these pores. Yeah, so this is a current as a function of time for pores that are open for tens of seconds. So you see here it's 80 picoamps, and then you see one closure event, another closure event, and then everything is gone. Okay. So to summarize this part, I just want to show you now that we have now a DNA channel with a nominal inner diameter of 2 nanometers. It's designed by having 6 double-stranded DNA molecules held together by this DNA nanotechnology designed to make an opening of 2 nanometers. Okay, so the opening here inside was supposed to be 2 nanometers. If you reduce the voltage when you assemble this, you actually the pore opens. Okay, the nice thing about this was that Stefano Walker made a nice cover with Stefano Walker that was actually on Angewandte Chemie a few years ago, so it looks very nice. This is of course a cartoon, so it's not how it probably really looks, but I will come to this now. Okay. When we saw this, okay, we thought, okay, ion channels are clearly smaller. Yeah, so ion channels have a smaller conductance. We saw today Professor Brown showed a conductance channel that was much smaller, this KV7 something. So we thought that, okay, can we perhaps make a smaller channel that is actually much less conductive? So what we did then in my group, we took now the same idea and made now, again, this is a wireframe diagram of our channel. So we have now a much simpler structure, it's much smaller, and we only have 4 double helices. Yeah, we have 1, 2, 3, 4 double helices that are held together by these holiday junctions at these positions. And if you make a rough representation of the system in a computer, each of these rods now is a double-strand DNA molecule. We also changed the chemistry now a little bit because now everything is commercially available. So we added fluorescent labels here, size 3 dyes. So we went away from the porphyrin just to have a life a little bit easier for ourselves because we can buy everything. And we added cholesterol tags here that are making everything hydrophobic. Okay. So to just show that you can actually draw them onto lipid membranes, we use confocal microscopy. So this is a giant unilamellar vesicle. If you add these pores with the labels without the cholesterol anchors, you just see that none are adhering to the lipid bilayer. However, if you add the cholesterol anchors, you actually find here that they adhere. But I also would like to say here that, well, how Carsten did this experiment, that you actually added the cholesterol into the mixture during the imaging, okay? What means you can assemble these nanopores in 60 seconds. Okay, so in 60 seconds, this ring forms. What means you have an extremely fast system for assembling ion channels, because you could mix or change these different staple strands, add a different functionality here, and within 60 seconds, you could have a different functionality in this kind of system. So you could really think about, in the future, again, this is a blue skies idea, that you have a patient with a certain disease, you mix these strands together, and then you make a different ion channel that has different gating characteristics, or maybe a target a different cell line, or other things. Yeah, so this is really something that you could reconfigure within minutes if you have a library of these staple strands. Okay, so the idea was now here that we had a diameter of 0.8 nanometers inside. Yeah, so this is really just the distance between these helices is just 0.8 nanometers. This is just extracted from the rough system. Okay, so what you then do, you can again do this patch clamping type experiment. So we draw the vesicles on there, and then if you have a structure, we actually see an ionic current. It's all fine and good. And then you can also see again gating events. So here you see a particular nice one where we have a stable insertion. So you see here the current, the voltage we apply, and the current. If the pore doesn't gate, you see this black line as it's going up and up and up. And then if you reach 50 or 80 millivolts, they also sometimes close here, so they switch to a lower conductance state, and then different in conductance. You can also see gating or gating-like events. I don't know if we should call it gating, but you definitely see that there are strong ion fluctuations in these kind of systems. You also see nice insertion events. So at higher voltages, DNA number force can go into a closed state. And we definitely also have ionic currents through this very small pores. Okay, and then we did something what was pretty stupid, I think, because we are confident. We went to a friend who does all atom molecular dynamic simulations, okay? Because the nice thing in principle, we said, hey, we know exactly how our channel looks. Perhaps we can calculate the conductance of this channel. And this is an all atom molecular dynamics model from Alexei Eximentiev in Urbana. And this is champagne, and this is how it looks, okay? So this is a channel here now, so from two different sides. So this is one view. So you see here the lipid membrane. The head groups are indicated by these small balls. And this is the structure. So first of all, you see that, of course, this channel is not as stable as an ion channel because it's some kind of flexibility, but this can be alleviated by changing this design here. So you see a wireframe diagram. And now comes the, for us, the interesting part, that you actually see that the lipid molecules tilt around this hydrophilic structure. Perhaps it should have been expected, but you definitely see that they are tilting their heads towards this DNA structure. Okay, when we saw this, we thought, okay, if the lipid head groups tilt, then you should have a water pathway here, and then the ion should flow. Okay, so then the obvious question is, can we actually build a DNA-based channel from a single helix? And this is in the end what we did now. So we made everything every much simpler. Okay, so what we now went back to Eugen Stulz and said, we need a single DNA duplex who actually has hydrophobic belt along its central. And this is what he gave us. So we have a DNA duplex with a length of roughly 5 nanometers. And we have now these porphyrin molecules again. This is why it's red anchors that are distributed around the molecule. This is an AFM image, of course, looks not very structural because this is just a rod, basically. And now you can do exactly the same. You expose them to lipid membrane, and then you nicely see single insertion steps and 60 picosiemens of conductance. You actually see closure events where you pull them out at high voltages, and you see all kinds of fluctuating current events in these kind of systems, okay? You also see a relatively well-defined conductance histogram for these single helix ion channels, and you also get linear IV characteristics. And of course, we can also now ask Alexei Eximentiev to make a MD model of these kind of ion channels, and again, you see very similar things. So you have these two lipid sheets, and then the lipid head groups tilt, and this is actually why there's an ion flow flowing through this, okay? Of course, as a physicist, this makes me very happy, because I think this is actually how some ion channels will work as well, but we can have a discussion about this, of course, later. Okay, so since I'm running out of time, I just want to show you that we, of course, don't have only went not only to the small side of things, so this is a duplex ion channel that we have with a small conductance, but we also now have this huge porin that has an inner diameter of 6 nanometers, and has a conductance of up to 40 nanosiemens, so you can really build a whole range of structures covering molecular weights of from a few 10 kilodaltons to megadaltons that are covering this kind of systems. We can go from basically ion lipid head group of 1 nanometer channel to a 6 nanometer channel and have this all under control. So this is my conclusion, okay? So we started with this a few years ago that we have a 4-helix-based ion channel, 6-helix-based ion channel. Now we have a huge porin, and what we find very interesting is a DNA duplex because you can make it in high quantities. So I think that shows that we can use DNA origami for building mimics of proteins. DNA nanochannels can transport ions to lipid membranes. They are selective. I didn't show this here. And we can now build kilodalton to megadalton size structures. And just to be a little bit challenging, I would like to end with a quote from Richard Feynman that what I think is really here, what I cannot create, I do not understand. So my goal is really, or our goal is really to create ion channels from the bottom up to really understand how they work. Thank you very much for your attention.
Yeah, it talks a lot about conductance. What about ion selectivity? Have you considered that?
Yes, so measuring this at the moment, so they are, of course. Okay. So,
Can you see this here? Not really, I didn't bring the plot, but what you already can see because of the cost, the DA is highly negatively charged, you are already selected for positive ions. Yeah? So that in the simulation it looks like 90, 95, 99%, so it's already pretty good. We have to measure this in the measurement, and this proved a little bit difficult, but we are doing this at the moment. We are now trying to do this with optics, and it looks selective for positive ions, but we don't have selective yet for potassium or sodium, but there are some ideas. So actually for this guy, we actually added here G-product neck structure, so to make a potassium selective site on this side. There are some other issues with that, but there are motifs that you can use to make it ion selective, but this is the next step, yes.
What is the nature of the media that you expose these to?
So at the moment we use very clean solutions, so only is salt, 1 molar KCl just to make easy, pH 6 or 8, so we have this kind of thing. We also tested them on cells. They adhere to cell membranes, what they do is a different question. Yeah. So some people in the literature say they kill them. I think, yes, they kill them, but the mechanism is not clear. Okay, so of course, one idea would be to add them to cells and then see if you disrupt the membrane potential. We also add them to heart cells and you see different beating, but the control measurements
are... You know that there's normally there's a diffuse double layer, okay, which yeah. determines the potential within the membrane, which yes. is the potential of interest. So, and one of the ways you can explore that double layer is, for example, with divalent cations.
Yes.
Have you done anything along those lines?
So, along those lines, we played around a little bit. So, all these structures only, all these structures contain a little bit of magnesium ions. But then you add this one to cells, of course, they die. Now we can take the sodium ion, and you can also make different structures that are stable in PBS, so there's no problem. But we didn't look at how the double layer exactly work on cells. We want to do this in the future, but this is very much a start.
So how important is the liquid, lipid composition in close vicinity to the membrane? Because you can maybe speculate that these pores are more flexible and less rigid than frozen.
Good question. So we are looking at this at the moment. So we used in the test bending setup or system, we used POP-C and DPHPC, so two types of lipids. We know that these pores adhere or interact with bacterial membranes, but also with normal cells, so HeLa cells, also with stem cells. But what they are doing is a different question, because there's competition with different surface proteins anyway. They will be a lipid dependent, I think, so we also put cholesterol in the lipid membrane sometimes to make them a little bit more flexible, so that helps. From the MD simulation, the guys also expect that these structures deform depending on the lipid pressure. So in principle, these are mechanosensitive channels. Okay, so actually they should expand and contract with different voltages. So they would be sensors for stress. This is something to do.